Welcome to ATC, the Emergency Medicine Channel. Today we'll be discussing a patient who came to our ER in a gasping state. So the 54-year-old female patient was brought to our ER on a trolley in a gasping state. The short history we got was the patient was brought to the hospital with complaints of progressive breathlessness for the past 3 days. On our initial assessment, the patient was gasping and the carotid pulse was absent. So immediately we started...
What pulse was absent?
Carotid pulse. So immediately we started cardiac resuscitation as per ACLS protocol. Our chest compressions were initiated at a rate of 100 to 120 per minute, and at that time we already alerted the staff about the arrest, and the other people were also alerted. So as soon as more people were available, I handed over the compression to the next person and assigned one person for AMBU ventilation.
So the patient was brought unresponsive or in gasping state. So initially you assessed and she was unresponsive, and there was no palpable carotid pulse, so you initiated on cardiac compression. So can you elaborate on how did you start the cardiac compression, and what is the rate of compression that you have started at this point of time?
The patient actually was brought in a trolley, so in a supine position actually we lowered the height so for ease of compression, and with the palm of the hand placed in the lower part of the breastbone, compression was given at a rate of 100 to 120 per minute.
100 to 120 compression per minute.
So our aim is to actually give a depth of about 1/3 of the AP diameter of the patient. With that depth and a rate of 100 to 120, we start compression.
Okay. So, before that starting compression, you need to have any preparations to be done?
The most important is personal protective equipments.
So, you have to verify that scene is safe. So, the prior receiving to the patient, you have to make sure that you are wearing all your PPE and you are ready to receive this patient. So, in emergency room, we can't expect after the patient arrival to wear this. So, first make sure that your scene is safe and you enter to the scene. And prepare for CPR. What are the other things that you need to consider while you are initiating CPR?
One thing is actually we have to arrange all the support equipments like a crash cart and other.
So it will be there in the emergency room. So we will be receiving in your resuscitation area. So most importantly, while doing compression, what is the priority? You have to make sure that the compressions are effective. So to make sure that effective, the patient should be placed in a
CPR board.
What is CPR board? You can just tell what is the requirement of a CPR board.
Basically, CPR board is actually a hard board that we place under the chest of the patient. It can actually improve the outcome of the while we are giving compression. Actually, it can give a hard surface and the underneath of the shoulder blade to improve the effectiveness of CPR.
So the primary requirement to start your CPR is the patient should be supine, lying on her back, and should be on a hard surface. So that is a primary requirement. Either on the right side or left side, you can start the compression at a rate of 100 to 120. So each cycle is 30 compression followed by two rescue breaths. So that you have initiated. So and you have alerted the team members to be ready to start the further proceedings. So how many team members you need and how will you assign each team members a role?
Ideally, if we have availability, we can assign 6 team members.
Okay.
One will be a team leader.
And
then one person will be doing the compression. And one will be handling the airway. And one for IV access. And one for the defibrillation and the monitoring part. And another person for recording all the events. He can remind about the drug medications and everything. And also note the whole event, which can be used for debriefing at the end of the resuscitation.
So, what should be the method of communication that you should be using within your team members?
And the most important is closed-loop communication. Whenever we are giving an order, the person who is supposed to do the thing actually have to respond back. The thing is actually whenever he is getting the order, he should respond back. And once you have done the thing also, we have to respond back that he has done it.
What should be the instruction that you have to give your team leader or whoever it is? What should be the type of instructions?
Basically, it should be very clear communication, like how much dose and which route, like that. We have to be very clear and precise about our communication.
So clear instructions and closed loop communication. That is a priority. Then you initiated the CPR. So here, then when one person can switch over. So as you said, you initiated the CPR. Then you said you handed over to someone else and you became the team leader. So when you will do the switching over?
Ideally, we can switch over at 2 minutes or one full cycle, or sometimes if the patient is feeling fatigue beforehand also, we can switch.
Or the person is feeling fatigue or
after
two minutes. five cycles of CPR. Or you can maybe in between you are connecting to the defibrillator, at the time you are having a rhythm check. Maybe you will get less than 10 seconds. At the time also, maybe the initial phase, you can have a changeover. So whatever be the thing, your interruption should not be more than
10 seconds.
So the patient is in front of you. You initiated the CPR. You assigned roles for the team members. Now proceed.
What should be the ideal level of the bed?
It should be below the waistline, like this area.
So you are
people will be having different heights, no? The resistance team.
Should be at the level of the person who is giving the compression, like below the waistline.
So that is one thing. Maybe you have to use some step boards,
step board or something,
and increase the height, or you need to sometimes climb over the bed and need to give the compression. So in ER trolleys will be narrow, so we'll not be able to climb over, so that we have placed step boards. So in a ward and all, you will have the bed will be wider. So you can climb over the bed and you can start giving the compression. And giving compression, most important thing, qualities of CPR you have to maintain. So five qualities of CPR.
One is we have to push hard and push fast, and then we have to maintain the rate of 100 to 120 per minute, and then we have to compress at a depth of 1/3 AP diameter, and we have to give adequate time for chest recoiling.
How will you assure that your quality of CPR is good in a clinical scenario?
One thing is, if an observation by another person that they are saying like that you are not doing it adequately, like that one is.
That's a subjective.
Subjective.
But it's.
Second is ETCO2. We have to maintain it above 10. If it's going below 10, it's inadequate our quality.
So you have to connect to an end tidal carbon dioxide, but in a setting where you, for this patient you have not intubated. So end tidal carbon dioxide with the nasal cannula will be difficult at this point. So once the patient have a definitive airway, or you have something like a supraglottic airway which you can connect to an ETCO2, at that time you can have ETCO2 monitoring, and other will be the feedback devices. You have to use the feedback devices. So that is a recommendation by AHR right now. So you should have, all CPR should have a feedback devices. So that feedback devices will give you whether you are doing it in the right or wrong, whether you need to increase the rate or decrease the rate, or whether you need to maybe the depth, everything will be given by the feedback devices. Okay.
So with the people we have, we arrange one person for compression and one for ambubendation, and one person was alerted to be get to a large bore IV access, and also sent for all routine investigations including an ABG. And one person was asked.
See, routine investigation you should not say. This is a cardiac arrest scenario. So cardiac arrest scenario, what investigation you want? You want to rule out 5H and 5Ts. So depending on that, you have to ask for your investigation. Should not routine investigation, urine routine. You want a urine routine cardiac arrest? No. So you have to be very specific in what investigation you wanted. So what is the investigation that you want?
One is we want a total blood count.
Why?
Cardiac arrest.
During resuscitation. Okay.
Which all investigation?
Maybe an ABG will do.
A blood gas. Blood gas. Ideally, it gives your acid-base disorder, but certain blood gas will have all your electrolytes available. So you have to look for what are the 5H and 5Ts.
Hypoxia, hypovolemia, then hydrogen anisosis, hyperkalemia, and hypothermia.
Okay.
Then tension pneumothorax, then toxins, then coronary and pulmonary thrombus, and also this thing.
Pneumothorax. So this you have to look, and you have to have the investigation accordingly. So don't ask for all the routine investigation. Don't waste your time and resources. Then what you did for this patient?
And also one person was asked to connect to the defibrillator.
Okay.
So as soon as it was ready, the person alerted us, and actually, and then also one person was asked to get a history from the bystander.
Okay. So
you have asked, you told that IV access was obtained. So suppose you are not getting an IV access, what are the alternatives in cardiac arrest?
One thing is we can use an endotracheal route.
If you are not intubated, no?
Or else we can go for IO access. IO, IV, and also endotracheal route can be used.
So when will you decide, okay, my IV is getting failed, I should go for an IO access?
According to the newer guidelines, actually IO is not an ideal preference. So actually, even if you're not getting, we have to ask them to try with the senior person who is actually more.
So senior person has failed twice.
Then we can think about an IV.
See,
one more time,
and you can go for an IO access. See, there is no contraindication for an IO access. See, when you are not getting an IV access, you can definitely need to have an access. You have to think over and put an IO access. There are newer devices that is available. Very easily you can go ahead and put your IO access. So that is not freely available in India. Once it is available, you can go ahead and do an IO. So that is not a big deal. So you have to have an IO access when it is failed. Or as you said initially, when the patient is intubated, you can go for your endotracheal via your endotracheal tube. So which all drugs you will give via endotracheal tube?
We can give an naloxone, then lignocaine, atropine, then
epinephrine. So what is the mnemonic?
Enable.
Lean. Lignocaine. epinephrine, atropine, naloxone. So these are the four drugs that can you deliver through your endotracheal tube. And what will be the dose?
2 to 2.5 times the addition.
2 to 2.5, 3 to 10. Oh, it will vary. So usually twice or thrice the dose, whatever you are giving as an IV, you have to give it as via your endotracheal tube.
Followed by saline,
and you have to do a 5 amps QC. So then only the drug will be delivered. So that is the other methodology that you can use. Okay, continue.
So we have started compression and ambu ventilation and got an IV access, and now the defibrillator has been connected. So once it has been ready, the person alerted us, and so we stopped CPR and checked the rhythm. The rhythm was showing asystole, it was a flat line. So you immediately went for a asystole protocol.
Okay. So you have connected the defibrillator, and the person said the defibrillator is connected. You have stopped the CPR and you started analyzing the rhythm.
And what are the key things to remember once you're connecting the defibrillator? What could be the problems you can anticipate?
The first thing is actually we have to make sure all leads are properly attached and the right positions. And also, we have to check for the gain. Sometimes the gain can be too low. It can actually hide a VF as an asystole. And also, we have to check the power of the thing, machine to connect to the power circuit. So the most common drugs we can have. So in this patient, this all has been checked and the...
So that is otherwise called as your flat line protocol. You said as three things need to be assessed. Fine.
And this all we checked and it was still showing an asystole. So immediately continued CPR and asked to give 1 milligram epinephrine over the IV route. So
now we have to give a clear instruction. 1 milligram of what?
Epinephrine.
1 milligram of?
1 in 10,000.
1 in 1,000 dilution. Epinephrine. IV followed by 20 ml saline flush. So that is a clear instruction. So you have to 1 ml of 1 in, so that is what is available. 1 ampoule is 1 ml.
1 milligram.
That is 1 in 1,000 dilution. You have to give it as an IV
followed by
20 ml of saline flush. Okay.
And we can be repeated every 3 to 5 minutes. And we also instruct the recorder to remind the person to give it every 3 to 5 minutes. And so it was given and the CPR was continued. And at that time we also arranged for intubation.
Why intubation?
Recent studies, so actually, especially in case of asystole, early intubation can actually improve the outcome of resuscitation.
Okay, so there is no harm in intubation unless and until you are not wasting your time. You are not interrupting your CPR. Without interrupting your CPR, only at the time of you are introducing the tube, you can ask them to stop the compression. And within 10 seconds, you have to introduce the tube and you have to start your compression back. So without interrupting the CPR, you are able to go ahead and intubate. But intubation should not interrupt your CPR and it should not be withheld for a long time. So if you are not able to intubate at that point of time, you can think of other agents like supraglottic airway devices, or you can just continue with your positive pressure ventilation, that is your bag mask ventilation. You can just continue with your bag mask and continue that. So intubation at this point, if it is a hypoxic arrest, suppose you have resuscitated someone drowning and you are pretty sure that it's a hypoxic arrest, then intubation is the priority. So in compression, in cardiac arrest, it is the CAB, compression, airway and breathing. But in drowning cases, definitely intubation has got a priority because hypoxia is the cause of arrest. Fine.
When you have a very much patent airway, your good ambu bag and left with a good seal is good enough for the ventral part of the resuscitation. Okay.
So in this patient, we visualized the airway ongoing CPR, and once it was confirmed, we asked to stop the CPR and intubated the patient. And we used a 7.5 size CT tube and fixed at 20 angle of mouth. And then immediately continued CPR.
Then you connected to an ETCO2.
Yeah, they connected to an ETCO2 monitor. At that time, monitor was showing 12.
12. Okay. So you should have a continuous ETCO2 monitoring. That is the key. Should have a continuous ETCO2 monitoring. One thing, you have confirmed the two position with the help of ETCO2. Two, quality of your CPR. You need improvement of the quality. And third will be?
ROSC.
Whether ROSC is achieved or not. What will happen when ROSC, that is return of spontaneous circulation. What will happen?
There will be sudden spike in ETCO2.
Okay. What will be the use of our ETCO2? What is the other use?
Next will be monitoring of the patient post.
Post-monitoring or termination of CPR. If ETCO2 is persistently low, even after 20 minutes of CPR, it is persistently low, there is no improvement, then that is the time when you can think of termination of CPR.
So, firstly, we confirmed the tube position by 5-point auscultation and we connected the ETCO2 monitor and then continued our CPR. And by this time, so primary assessment pattern, actually airway, breathing, circulation, everything is actually secured within the CPR resuscitation. And
did you mention about the BP?
There's no BP. So by this time actually the intern got the history of the patient. The patient actually had a history of cough and breathlessness for the past 3 days and was slowly worsening over time. She is a follow-up of here under med oncology and hematology, and so they were planning to come to the OPD for further evaluation. But on arriving at the hospital, she had a sudden onset of worsening of symptoms, and so because of gasping, they immediately shifted the patient to the ER.
Because of breathlessness, they shifted her to ER. Yeah. So primarily, we are thinking in terms either it can be an hypoxia related. We can, from the history, whatever is available, she had some hypoxia related issue. Maybe anemia induced cardiac failure, maybe a sepsis, we are not very sure. Some hypoxia is the primary, or maybe a metabolic acidosis also. We are not very sure what is happening to her. Okay.
So, remaining history, she doesn't have any non-drug allergies, and she's a non-case of type 2 diabetes and also autoimmune hemolytic anemia.
So, meanwhile, your CPR is getting continued. You have achieved the ROSC?
No.
You have not achieved the ROSC. So, that is the clarity. So, without interrupting the CPR, somebody has gone outside and collected the history. So, ideally, only after the ROSC, everything, if you are alone, you should be concentrating on your compression, then only you will be getting the history. So, somebody has gone and collected the history. That is why you are able to tell this now.
So she's a non-case of type 2 diabetes and also autoimmune hemolytic anemia under follow-up on the hospital. So with this, actually, we also, parallel to the ongoing CPR, we sent some adjuncts also. GRBs was checked, was 228, and ABG came, and the ABG was showing severe metabolic acidosis.
Severe metabolic acidosis, in the sense, what is the pH?
pH is 6.67 with a bicarb of 4.2. PCO2 was 37.8 and PO2 was 91.7. And electrolytes were within normal limits. Sodium was 131 and potassium was 4.3. And lactate was 23.
Lactate was 23. So what do you think the reason for her arrest would be?
One may be metabolic acidosis induced this thing. And also HP was also too low. 6.8 was the HP.
6.8 causing a cardiac arrest? How cardiac unlikely? She is a known case of autoimmune hemolytic anemia. So what we are expecting, somewhere around 7-8 only. But it is some severe lactic acidosis. Severe lactic acidosis can be secondary to a part of your hypoperfusion or hypoxia or a sepsis. So this is the differential diagnosis that we can have at this point of time. Then, what was done with this pH? You had added any drugs at this point of time?
We gave sodium bicarbonate was given.
Sodium bicarbonate was given. So what are the indications for sodium bicarbonate in a cardiac arrest? Overall, you will give sodium bicarbonate.
Sodium bicarbonate is mainly given to prevent in a very low pH, less than 6.9 or something, we can consider giving sodium bicarbonate.
Hyperkalemic
and also in hyperkalemic cardiac arrest.
Then, somebody who is taking tablets for depression.
TCA toxicity.
So definitely when you look into indications of soda bicarbonate, it is routinely not recommended unless and until your pH is severely low, like less than 6.9, and you can think of giving soda bicarbonate, and there is an associated hyperkalemic cardiac arrest. Irrespective of your pH, you can consider giving soda bicarbonate, and irrespective of pH, again in tricyclic antidepressant toxicity, maybe a relative indication but not recommended anywhere by AHA. But there has been a lot of practice, maybe a prolonged cardiac arrest, because prolonged cardiac arrest, in the sense, there will be pH will be less than 6.9, where you can try a trial of bicarbonate. So what is the dose of bicarbonate, soda bicarbonate, that you will use?
You can give 1 ml per kg,
Formula is 24 minus the bicarb of the patient into body weight divided by 2.
So you will get a deficit. She will get a deficit, something like 360 milliequivalent, some deficit you will get. And in from that deficit, you have to take half, and you can give it as a, try to give bolus. It as an initial bolus and rest as an infusion. That is one thing that you can do. And depending upon the availability of soda bicarbonate, there are two preparations that is available. You have 8.4 and
7.8.
8.4 preparation is 1 ml, 1 milliequivalent. Other one is 1 ml will not, around 0.8. So 50 ml will be somewhere around 42, 43 milliequivalents only. There is no major difference, but when you are giving it as a prolonged infusion and all, there will be some change of like 30 to 40 milliequivalents. So these are the two preparations that is available. So easily you can remember 1 ml per kg, you can give it as a bolus. And that is only in these three conditions, routinely not indicated. Routinely only one drug that you need to give in a case of systole or PA is your epinephrine. Epinephrine, adrenaline, every 3 to 5 minutes. If needed, you can consider giving soda bicarbonate as we discuss the indications.
Considering the lactate, we also give a fluid bolus of 1 liter. And also, blood was arranged for, arrangement was also given, and CPR was continued. And because of the persistent cardiac arrest, we also went through all the reversible causes of cardiac arrest, and this patient may be having hypoxia induced or hypovolemia induced.
We have multiple reasons here.
Multiple reasons, sepsis induced like that. We all went through all these possible causes, and after the 6th cycle, ROSC was attained.
After the 6th cycle, it is not right. One cycle is 30:2.
Not 6th cycle, yeah.
So maybe after approximately around 15th minute or 12 minutes, after the 12 minutes.
About 18th minute the cycle, this was.
Okay. See, one cycle of CPR is 30:2. Only after 5 cycles of CPR you are reassessing. So if you, what you said is like 6 into 5. After 30 cycles of CPR, you have got your ROSC. You have achieved your ROSC. So how will you confirm that this patient has achieved an ROSC?
One thing is actually we got an organized rhythm in the monitor and was confirmed by a carotid palpable carotid pulse.
Okay, suppose you have an organized rhythm, no carotid pulse.
Then it is a pulseless electrical activity.
So what you have to do?
We have to immediately continue CPR. So this patient was having pulse. Also the ETCO2 has come up to about 48 like that.
So there was a rapid increase in ETCO2. Again confirm your ROSC. So that was the, you made sure that your ROSC was achieved. Okay, fine. After achieving the ROC, what you did?
So now we have attained ROC, we went with the post-cardiac arrest care. And so starting from ABCD, like
reassessment.
From airway. So airway we already secured with 82. So now we again confirmed the patency and everything is maintained. And there was no difficulty in giving AMBU or anything. And so with the breathing part, with AMBU ventilation, we are getting adequate chest rise and bilateral equal air entry was there. There was no any added sounds, nothing was present. And then we connected the patient to the ventilator. And ventilator PCV mode was selected with the pressure support of 16 with a PEEP of 5 and IEC ratio 1:2.2. And tidal volume was achieved around 480 was achieved. And
pressure control of 16.
And the breathing pattern, and so airway breathing is secured. And we went with the circulation. We got a heart rate of 122 per minute and a BP of 100 by 70, which was maintaining. And we also took an ECG. It was showing a sinus tachycardia of 120 per minute. So considering this more like on a medical case, we after management, we admitted the patient in critical care unit and further managed the patient.
Post-cardiac arrest, most important?
Most important, the patient's disability part, the patient was not responding to commands after this thing. So we also initiated target temperature management.
Otherwise, previously called as therapeutic hypothermia. So what is the recommendations?
Recommendation is actually we have to maintain a reduce the temperature to maintain a temperature of 32 to 36 degrees Celsius to at least 24 to 48 hours.
Minimum 24 hours.
Normothermia.
At least normothermia for minimum 24 hours.
So we don't have to push too low, like to 32 or something. 34 to 36 is good enough.
That is normothermia. You can somewhere around 36 degrees acceptable.
You can use cold salines or even cold ice packs, everything can be used.
You think these all things will decrease your temperature?
What we generally use here is actually cold saline infusion.
It will not improve, it will not, nothing will happen. You have to have proper cooling blankets or cooling devices to have a proper therapeutic hypothermia, because since the cost factor is very high, that is not freely available or used in India. So we want to go for a really adequate therapeutic hypothermia. You have to use the bear huggers and you have to control the temperature and you have to have the core body temperature from to have 34 to 36 degrees Celsius. So that is a, what is the recommendation. Then what will you prognosticate the bystander at this point of time?
The thing is actually a person who has went into cardiac arrest always has a grave prognosis actually, and we have to tell the patient the cardiac prognosis, because there is any at any point the patient can go for a repeat arrest. That is one thing, and also the patient will require prolonged ICU care. And
so when you can give, see, I can tell you, okay, after this many days I can prognosticate you this thing, because right now anything can happen. Next she can have any time a cardiac arrest because she is having severe acidosis. So when you can expect, like after like 3-4 days, when you can tell that exactly?
So after
72 hours.
So initial period you don't have to go for, like only imaging in the initial 24 hours can be a CT to rule out any other causes of arrest. only after like around 72 hours we can book an MRI or EEG to document if any hypoxia related
ischemia related is there. That is the one thing that you have to tell the bystander.
Mm.
Maybe she is holding her heart rate, maybe she is holding her blood pressure, but her hypoxia part we cannot assure now. Only after 3 days, approximately 3 days, we can tell regarding how she is going to improve, and maybe you need to do an EEG, you need to do your MRI. Only not initially, it is not recommended unless until you have a definitive indication to do an MRI.
What's the role of ultrasound in resuscitation, RPT resuscitation?
One thing is actually during ultrasound, if it is not hampering or intercepting the actual process of cardiac resuscitation, we can use it to check the cardiac activity and.
Tension,
you can on things,
tamponade.
Any role in PEA?
In PEA, actually, even if you're not able to feel a pulse, sometimes cardiac activity is intended by a
CASA protocol.
Is point of care ultrasound.
CASA protocol?
Using point of care ultrasound to diagnose cardiac activity during PEA.
So you can, that is one of the important tools that you can use. You can look for your tamponades. You can look for your pneumothorax and also PE. And maybe sometimes you can look for the volume status, pulmonary embolism, RARV, what is happening. All those things can be reasonably very good. You can get it from your ultrasound. So definitely there is a role of ultrasound. Slowly that is going to come up with the AHA protocols also. Now they are recommending, but not as a primary. Any role for mechanical compression devices?
Especially in case of new COVID times, actually they are suggesting mechanical compression in patients. To avoid much closer contact and also.
So where all you can, COVID you said, where all you can use mechanical compression devices? Which all areas mechanical compression devices is going to be very helpful? What do you feel?
One is,
if the scene is not safe or if we don't have... We don't have enough people.
Enough hands, okay. Then?
When prolonged CPR.
Prolonged CPR. Maybe in a cath lab area where you can't have everyone exposed for a radiation and you don't have enough gowns. So you need to continue compression. Maybe the patient has been brought in arrest, MI, you are taken to the cath lab. That is one area. During your transportation inside your ambulance, so where you can't stand and give good compression. So these are the priority areas where definitely a mechanical compression devices can do. Impedance threshold devices, roads.
Assess the quality of CPR.
Impedance threshold devices. These are all like a, you can attach it to your bag mask ventilation so that you can continuing the positive pressure ventilation. These are all devices not to be proven effective. So these are all trials that has been rejected by AHA. Only thing is the mechanical compression device. Anything
so? What do you mean by ECPR?
ECPR actually, if we have the facility available, we can, and it's not hampering the actual resuscitation, we can, it's more like an ECMO only. Basically, we connect to the femoral vein and artery and bypass the circulation to provide extracorporeal oxygenation system. So basically, if the patient's having a like a probable chance of good prognosis, we can go for this. If it is not, it is easily facilitatable. Like if the facility is having that kind of an this thing, we can give.
Any role of steroids in cardiac arrest?
Steroids are not usually recommended in cardiac resuscitation, but except in very few cases. Like in hospital cardiac arrest, it has some studies have shown that giving Dexa or something boros can.
Dexona
can actually.
Dexamethasone
can actually
improve
the outcome of CPR.
There is only a few studies that have shown that Dexona, dexamethasone 4 mg can be given as a trial for in-hospital cardiac arrest. And it has shown to improve the outcome. Routinely, no role of steroid, no role of pericardial thumping, no role for intracardiac drugs. No role, only role is your proper CPR is the holds the key and the drug that you need to remember is adrenaline. Unless and until you are not dealing with them. Shockable rhythms, then the treatment algorithm is totally different. It's a non-shockable rhythm and PEA will be the same algorithm.
How long will you continue your CPR?
And according to the newer guideline, actually, if you have patient connected to the ECG monitor and it's not showing an improvement even for 20 minutes, we can think about terminating the CPR. And other things will be one, if the people who are involved in the CPR is getting fatigued after prolonged this thing. And also, previously it used to say actually 40 minutes of persistent SSRI and all the chance of reverting by the patient is also much less.
So there is no correct time frame as such. You cannot say like it is 20 minutes I should stop CPR. These are all recommendations where you can think of stopping CPR. They have never said that you stop CPR after 20 minutes.
Mm.
You can think of terminating the CPR. So it all depends upon the treating physician and underlying pathophysiology, what happened to the patient, what is the reason for cardiac arrest, all depends. Which all circumstances you can have prolonging the cardiac arrest?
Especially in drowning, hypothermia and all.
Hypothermic cardiac arrest. Yeah. Unless and until the patient is warm, normal thermia, you can't declare him dead. So, when the patient has been recovered after drowning, you have to continue CPR and make sure that he is back to normal. Then only you can declare him, if even at all you want to stop CPR or declare him dead, the patient's temperature should be back to normal. Okay. Fine.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you.